So welcome everybody. Thanks very much for coming to this phase one webinar. Phase one's very kindly invited me to present the story behind the series of the SALT series. The SALT series has been the majority of my working life as an artist, as a photographer, and I've spent 25 trips now, 25 individual trips to the center of Lake Eyre, which is a giant salt pan in the right in the center of Australia in the desert. And the project itself has run from 2003, when I did my first exploratory visit, to a point where I took this image that's now on the screen and decided a bit later than this last year that would be it, that I'd call it a day on this image. So what I'd like to take you through basically is the journey that led from the start to this image. And I'm going to go right back to when I was first becoming a photographer, first learning my skills, my trade in the days of film. Not dwell there too long, but take it from there. But I'm going to start with a little video, which is from late in the series, just to give you all an idea of what it's like out there and what's involved in putting one of these projects together. So that's a brief intro to what it looks like. I'll just jump back to that. What it looks like out on the lake. Now, a bit of history. My programming in my family was certainly not or photography or the arts, but we had this old Hanamex camera that used to kick around the kitchen. And I was always fascinated with it. And although I never considered photography as a career, particularly growing up, I think my parents would have been much happier if I was a professional of some description. I was always fascinated, always attracted to the camera, and always attracted to the process of photography. For my final year in school, although I never studied art, I studied the physics of optics. And that has proved to be incredibly valuable to me going forward, going through my whole career. Having this understanding of what light does, how lenses work, how filters work, and all those kinds of things has been just been a wonderful grounding to what is essentially a very technical medium, but also an incredibly creative medium. Growing up, I was heavily into the outdoors, canyoning and stuff like that. This is exactly what we used to do quite a lot of, and I couldn't wait to get out into the bush as much as possible. When I left school, I was briefly for a couple of years in the Special Forces, and I trained as a medic, which I loved. And although I did it for experience, I guess you'd say, and what an 18-year-old thinks is fun, I think I learned some pretty valuable lessons that's led me to feel quite confident living alone in the bush for long periods of time. So I studied economics and politics at university. And as soon as I finished university, I went traveling. And at one stage, I ended up buying myself this old Enfield Bullet in India and took straight off to the Himalayas. And the experience of being up there alone predominantly and riding around these mountain roads just formed an imprint on my brain, this love, I guess, for what in artistic terms is known as a sublime experience, which is where the human experience is crushed by the power of nature, is overwhelmed. The human brain, the human mind becomes overwhelmed by things that are almost too big to grasp. The trip didn't end well. I ended up dropping that bike off one of those cliffs, and that's the bike after it was recovered. But I didn't feel like riding much anymore after that. So I went and did a whole bunch of short courses in photography, because when I came back from that trip, I really didn't want to deal with being an economist or getting a regular job or anything like that. And photography had by then completely overtaken my life, but I didn't know what I was doing. So I studied for a couple of years. And then I went back to the Himalayas. And this is a shot from my first exhibition. In fact, these are a couple of shots from my first exhibition. The very first expedition I did was a 6 or 7 month journey alone through the Himalayas, working my way from the east in Sikkim all the way to near the Indian-Pakistan border, where the Himalayas become the Karakoram in Ladakh and Kashmir. And during that time, I was alone a lot of the time. I was often with someone who didn't speak the language as a guide. And we often, although we became friends, kept to ourselves. And I had a lot of alone time, and I had a lot of time to think and respond. And I learnt, I think, what it was like to put yourself into a landscape with no exit for a long period of time. And just treat that as an experiment and see what images come out. So the first exhibition, first volume of work I did was in the Himalayas. The second volume of work I did was in Patagonia. And these are images from the second series, the second volume of work I did, which was a 6 month journey through the Altiplano in the north of Chile and Argentina, and then into the south, the Patagonian regions. That's a very, very familiar view. I'm sure many people have seen that. But just getting shots like this, what I learned to do was wait. And I remember camping 6 days until it cleared to get that shot. This is before the days of readily available weather forecasts. And then when I left Patagonia, had an exhibition and things seemed to be going well, so I really bit the bullet and started working in Tasmania at the bottom of Australia and started working in the southwest. And over five summers, I started trekking always on my own with a 4-5 camera in my backpack and film. And I'd go for up to 3 weeks at a time. And pretty sure I managed to walk all major trails in the southwest wilderness areas. And after 5 years of summers of doing this and one winter, I had my final exhibition in black and white, and my final exhibition of this style of landscape photography. It was pretty hard. It's something I wouldn't be able to do now. I was young and fit. But around about this time, I started to sense that what I was doing wasn't enough, and I wasn't going to cut it as an artist or as a photographic artist. So I took myself off to art school, and I'd never studied in art, but I was already working. I'd already had a number of exhibitions under my belt, and I was also starting to work as an architectural photographer. And that got me into art school and got me into a master's program just on industry experience, as they called it. And one of the most valuable things I did was study art history, or specifically the history of photography. And I realized almost instantly in my first year at art school that what I was doing, the style and the kind of photographs I was taking were contemporary or cutting edge in about 1900. And I stopped. I made a conscious decision to stop this kind of work right then. But I didn't simply stop landscape photography. I had these incredible experiences, this connection with very large, powerful, overwhelming landscapes that I wanted to continue with. And the challenge for me was to somehow work out a way of bringing that into the contemporary realm. So this image has been sitting here on the screen because this was taken on my honeymoon when my wife and I visited Salar de Uyuni in Bolivia, which is a giant salt plain very high up in the Altiplano. And I looked at that image, and I'll just go back. I looked at that image, and I looked at that image. And there was, even though I looked at it and said, well, it's no longer going to cut it in the contemporary sphere, the contemporary realm, there's a quality in these images that I love, that I don't want to let go. And for me, that was a sense of space. It was a sense that your mind melts and spreads out over the landscape. And I narrowed that down, I distilled it down to a point where I just came up with the question, would I be able to work with space as subject in itself? So my young family and I jumped in the car and we headed off to Lake Eyre. And this is the road into Lake Eyre. And a very young family there. This is 2003, so a long time ago now. And we started exploring. These images took from 2003 until 2005 to actually present themselves, for me to actually work out what I was doing out there. I tested 4-5, I tested early digital cameras, I tested different shots, I tested different methods of shooting, and I finally settled on a series, to approach a series where the horizon was completely pegged at the bottom of the frame, where there were no scale markers. I never showed the edge. So it was an attempt at semi-abstraction. And what I was doing was I was trying to, I'll jump back one. I was trying to convey to the viewer the experience of being out there, but putting myself into that place where I actually had the experience. I was still at university at the time, and my lecturer or my supervisor said, why don't you take a camera, a video camera out there and document what you're doing. So I did. So that was the trailer for a film, a very accidental film that came out of just recording the simplicity of what life was like out there. It was so familiar to me that it was almost boring recording what was going on out there. But I found when I brought it back, I showed it to some friends who were in the industry, a director, and they almost fell off their seats. And they were like, "This, there's a documentary in this." And in 2005, when this was taken, the whole idea of doing time-lapse photography, time-lapse video on digital, it wasn't really a thing. So a lot of the time-lapse you saw there of the Milky Way, which is now very familiar, and I look at the quality that we were getting out of digital cameras back in 2005, and it looks terrible in comparison to today's standards. But back then it was cutting edge. No one had really done it before. And there were some very personal moments, some revealing moments in the documentary and the way it was all put together. And it toured the documentary film circuits, and we did very, very well out of the awards. The project continued as it was. I was now working solely on an 810 camera using NEG. And I got very, very lucky. It's one of the driest places on earth, and this lake can go 10, even 20 years without any water in it. And twice during a drought, I was there when it rained. And I was able to walk out in ankle deep or sometimes knee deep water and shoot these incredible scenes. I started living on the lake, as you saw in that trailer. And that allowed me, one, it stopped me having to walk 5 to 7 kilometers out and 5 to 7 kilometers back each time I wanted to take a shot and miss a whole lot of stuff because I was in the wrong place. So I started living in the center of the lake permanently. And when it rained, I'd live on, there are occasional raised mounds of salt that you might've seen in that trailer as well. So I'd camp on those with water coming all the way up around the tent. And I'd stay out there for around 5 weeks at a time. And I'd work with all phases of the moon, all different phases of light, and I became obsessed with that line, the horizon line, and all its different shades that it picked up. Sometimes the horizon line was white, sometimes it was black, as you saw in that image. And sometimes when a storm was coming in, that's actually a massive dust storm on the edge of the lake, everything was just grayed out and you could barely see the sun. But the quality of light out there was something else. At times, you could go for weeks with absolutely nothing happening. And then this. That's the red dust hauled up into the atmosphere by a giant storm. But standing in the middle of the lake away from the storm, looking at it to the horizon, with those colours being picked up and mixed into the grey. And then when it was wet, it just became completely abstract. There was moments when you didn't know what you were looking at. You could only tell where the horizon was because the blue gradated to white at that point. So the work I've just been flicking through now covers a period from 2005, when I took my first exhibitable image, until 2008, when this image was taken. There was a point where I realized that the single frame wasn't enough to convey the space, and I felt, one, I'd captured everything I felt without. I felt if I tried to capture anything more, I'd be repeating myself. And I started becoming fascinated with working panoramically. In 2009, I changed over to medium format digital backs. I was finally convinced that I could get the quality out of the digital equipment that I could get out of the 810 film that was scanned. But more than that, I started to work out that I could stitch panoramically. Now, once again, stitching panoramically is something that's very familiar. Our iPhones do it. But back then when I took this shot, it was really the software involved and in making this kind of stuff work was still pretty hard to understand. And I remember to get this image with a straight horizon, I had to go back and forth with the software developers for many weeks to actually make this unwrap. Because when you take a panoramic photograph, it actually wraps it around a sphere, and then you have to tell the software what geometry to unwrap again and where to unwrap it with its straight lines. In 2009, the lake actually filled up not from rain, but from water from the inland system. This salt lake, Lake Eyre in the middle of Australia, is actually filled up every 10 or 15 years from heavy rainfall in the tropics that then takes 3 months to flow down. So there was plenty of advance notice that the lake was actually going to fill up. So in 2008, I'd given it away. I said, this project is over. I'm not doing any more. And then in 2009, I had this option of doing panoramic work with new technology, and I also had something new. I had the water flowing down from the north. So I got myself by canoe out to an island, and as the lake filled up over a month, I shot and shot and shot. I shot this, which was a massive local thunderstorm that came from probably from the water, evaporation off the water that was in the lake. And then here's an installation shot from my very first exhibition of this work, which gives you an idea of the scale of the images. Now, when I was on that island, I started to wonder if it was possible to put time-lapse together into a film and what that would look like. So I'll give you a little excerpt of the very first video work that I put together. Sorry for the abrupt finish there, guys. It goes on for too long. But you get the idea. I look at that now and I'm proud of what we did without any training, with pure experimentation, but I also look at the technical aspects of that now and consider it very, very rough. But there's some wonderful moments in there still. So in 2009, I gave away Lake Eyre. I had a hiatus from that project. And I'd actually said goodbye, that's it, to the families out there that supported me and gave me access to the lake. So I'd moved on to another landscape, a landscape that had a similar horizon, openness and emptiness that Lake Eyre did, to see if I could work in a similar way. And it was the Greenland ice sheet. Now, this is something that I really was out of my depth in. I had very, very little experience of working with the snow. I did a 1 day or 2 day a polar survival course, learning how to put up a tent and build a wall and all that kind of stuff. But I got absolutely smashed. I got helicoptered in straight into a storm. And then I spent the first 4 days just digging to stay alive. This is after 4 or 5 days. I was almost already buried, and constantly I was up every night trying to dig just to stop the snow from burying the tent. But we made a film, and here's a quick trailer from what we actually did there.
A long time ago, I made a decision that I wanted to work in this genre of landscape photography, in a place where there was minimal landscape, where there was almost nothing.
We come about 400 metres across the sea ice. It's too soft, too wet, and we can't go on.
There's a place in your mind where you try and rationalise things like the immensity of this place, the depth of the ice under my feet, the fact that this whole thing is moving towards the sea. Trying to understand infinity. Of dealing with things that are of a scale way beyond what the mind can take in. Those shots are so few and far between.
So that was a film that we made during that project. The Greenland project was 6 trips over 4 years, from 2010 to 2013 inclusive. And on the back of the documentary Salt, that did really well, the ABC in Australia funded us to do a documentary. Now, when I say us, the first trip I did up to Greenland was alone. But after that, I realised that I was just not equipped to photograph and also look after myself in bad weather up there. So I started working with the team, and eventually for the documentary worked with two Inuit guides who with 54 dogs took 3 sleds with 1.5 tons of equipment for a 2-month trip right across the Greenland ice sheet and then all the way back again. And it was a fantastic trip. We made a fantastic documentary, but the exhibition images didn't come until the 5th and finally the 6th trip. So it was very frustrating, very heartbreaking, and a very long way from home in a very, very hostile environment. Now, the reason we're looking at this bear, and this is not my shot, is that the closest call I've ever had was receiving a call late one night when I was on my own on the first trip and being told that there was a polar bear not far from my tent and that it must have picked up my scent, and that I was not to go to sleep, and that I was to sit up all night with my gun. I can safely say that that was one of the longest nights of my life. Luckily, in the blizzard, there was a massive blizzard that night, and I think the polar bear was turned around and went away, so it never turned up. But this level of adventure was something that I felt I didn't sign up for, and was nothing to do with the photography or the images that I was trying to take. And that led me to working with other people. Here's a wonderful production still of us shooting the doco. That was basically 5 to 6 weeks of just every day on the sled, every night setting up camp, and then shooting for the documentary, and hoping that these still images, which was the purpose of the trip, present themselves. It was a hostile environment, very hard to work, but also incredibly beautiful. This is how we camp as a group every night. We put our tents, we dug a hole and put our tents below the level of the snow, and then shoveled snow back up. That way the wind couldn't get underneath. We did get some wonderful shots though. This is probably my favorite shot from the ice sheet. You need to look that one up if you're interested to find out in what it is, but there's about 10 or 12 visual ice effects going on there at once. And that's quite a rare thing to see. So these are some of the images that were exhibited. That cloud mass on the right is not actually cloud. That's actually an aurora, but very early in the sunset. So it hasn't actually got its green color yet against the black sky. It's a very strong aurora. And that's not the moon, that's the sun through ice fog late in the day. Most of the shots that worked in Greenland came with these natural ice effects that appeared in the sky. Now, here's another little video. This is a video work that we put together. An excerpt from a video work called Borealis. And as you can see, the technical quality rapidly advanced in this time-lapse work. Once again, sorry to cut that off so abruptly. The music in that was by a good friend of mine called Tommy Schutzinger, who's a composer. But the storm sounds that were in the background of that were actual recordings of the Borealis effect. It actually makes sounds like a storm, but you can't hear them with the human ear. They're on certain radio waves. And there was a Canadian guy, I'm sorry, I can't recall his name, but he put out CDs, and we contacted him, and he was more than happy and more than gracious for us to work with us on that, with the sound. Now, on the sixth trip that I made to Greenland, the final one, the film project had finished. And I brought my friend, Tommy, the composer. This site that you're looking at is known as Die 2. It was part of the dew line, the distant early warning line, which preceded the satellites. And it was to detect if Russia launched nuclear missiles towards America. Now, the whole dew line was decommissioned in the 80s once the satellites started that detection job. But this station and one other, this is called Die 2, and there's another station called Die 3. They were just too hard to pull apart, so they were just left where they are. And they were abandoned with 2 hours' notice. So they're like living museums that no one's ever been to. Well, few people have ever been to. And this is what it looks like inside. You can see the medicines just and books and things like that just left on the table as people got up one morning. The beds are even made, and they were told to leave. A plane came and got them, and they just left it there. This was the mess area. And those writings are scribbles from expeditioners who've used this as a navigation point as they crossed the Greenland ice sheet. So these images were exhibited alongside the landscapes as well. And it really put an enjoyable end to what was a pretty grueling project. But we also made a video of this, which I'll play an excerpt of. And Tommy recorded sounds from within the station. He also brought sounds with him and played them back into the station and re-recorded them. So this was the radar in the top of the dome. So the radar wasn't working. I know people are going to ask this. We had to push it round and then loop the recordings.
If somebody had told me when I last left this place in August 1988 that nearly 25 years later, technology once again have my voice again, have my voice resonate, Die 2, the radio of Die 2. I probably would have said,
my name is Fred Teeter. I served on the dew line, the distant early warning system.
This is my 15 minutes of
from
fame,
my graduation
right?
in college in 1976 until sometime in 1977, after which I was transferred to Alaska and served until the fall of 1978. While in Greenland, I served at dye sites 2 and 3 on the ice cap and also coastal station.
So while Greenland wasn't going well, particularly in the early days, and Lake Eyre was off, I'd left that behind. I had this fascination with storms, but I felt, once again, how do you bring something like that into the contemporary world? So I came up with a similar method of working with the horizon and seriality, and I discovered that there was actually this place on the Tiwi Islands, which is almost inaccessible. Where this thunderstorm forms pretty much every day. It's the world's biggest thunderstorm. And during the right season, this thunderstorm forms every day. So I set up camp there and photographed it. And I used a technology that FaZe had just brought out, which was their achromatic camera. And I filtered it down to partial infrared. Now, these storms are a long way away, but by filtering out the blue light and using the partial infrared, I was actually able to see into the structure of the storms way past what the human eye could see, and particularly when it got to big prints, bringing out the detail. Here's a little video of what happened there.
Cool,
Bob down. Oh, that one was really close.
Whoa!
It's right on top of us now.
Once again, apologies for the abrupt finish there, guys. So these are some of the images that were taken as well on that trip. Like the Lake Eyre trip, this has turned into quite an epic project. There were, I think, 8 trips over 6 or 7 years. Often working for natural history documentaries as well, not just shooting my own work for exhibition. But I was very determined here to bring it out of what I call the storm chaser aesthetic by using this horizon motif that I'd set up and hopefully setting up a comparison between each image where the storms in an exhibition take on kind of an organic shape by themselves. We're not distracted by the foreground or the background. It's just the shape and pure energy of the storm itself. Now, in 2013, I'd finished Greenland and I'd pretty well finished going to shoot Hector, which was the thunderstorm. And it was right then that technology once again changed. There was a significant jump in particularly phases technology where they adopted CMOS sensors. Now, the significance of going from the CCD to the CMOS sensor meant that long exposures at night suddenly became possible. So these things that I'd been seeing in the time-lapse cameras for many, many years, but never had enough quality to go to large format exhibition, were suddenly available to be shot via this new technology. So what you see here is actually the first phase one CMOS, the Alpha FPS, and a 1.4 Astro lens. And for from 2013 to 14, this was the phase of the Lake Eyre project. Those circles that you see are actually the Lake Eyre lizard that burrows up, breeds and burrows back down when there's an inch of water over the lake in certain spots. So something actually does live in the salt. These were huge prints. They were massive 30,000, 40,000 pixel prints. And it was just wonderful to be able to work at that quality and get this work on the wall. And once again, staying with the horizon motif. So after this shot, I said, goodbye. That's got to be it. No more Lake Eyre. And that was at the end of 2014. In 2015, I did some other work. And then in 2016, I loaded up the car and was heading out into the outback in Australia to do some other work. And it bucketed down rain all the way across the centre of Australia. So I was unable to go to the place I was heading to. And I said, well, the car's ready. I've booked time off, everything like that. I may as well go to Lake Eyre. I've got a book project in mind. I'll go there and I'll just shoot, not to waste this time. And I was explaining to a graphic designer friend that what I was going to be able to shoot was like a 10-kilometer wide puddle, which acts as a mirror. And this designer said to me, oh, I work with mirrors. I built a whole pavilion for an international expo one year. And he explained to me his thing. And he talked about infinity and the mirrors. And I walked out of that conversation in a coffee shop. And as I was walking up the street, this idea mirror just sat in my head. And I wondered if I could somehow take mirrors out into Lake Eyre and extend the sense of space, just like with the panoramas. Somehow enfold space into a mirror inside the mirror, which was the lake shore. And by midday that day, I had two mirrors ordered from a set designer. And this was in the first week out there testing the mirrors for what became the Vanity series as part of the much larger Salt project. I was lucky enough to have a friend there on this one who took some great behind-the-scenes shots, a friend called Marcus O'Brien, who was very diligent getting me all these shots, and I thank him very much for them. And it was no longer living in the centre of the lake. It was living on the edge, and it was freezing. We brought wood from the farm and because there's not much out there, and we kept ourselves warm. We got into our wet gear in the middle of the night by the fire and headed out. And this is what we call maximum salt. We joked and we said, when you can pick up your shorts by the bottom and hold them straight up in the air, you've hit maximum salt and it's time to go home. So this was the first image that worked. And I remember looking on the back of the camera and thinking, that's not bad. There's something in that. So I still took an 810 camera out there, but just for these 5 to 7 hour exposures through the middle of the night. Once again, you can see elements from the very early work, working with those white lines, working with the gradations through the sky, and then reflecting the other side back across. This is one of my, that was often the cover image for some of the exhibitions that we had. So this is what it was like in some of the deeper places. You can see the mirror on the left is broken. It's fallen over and it's completely smashed. there's a wonderful install shot from Paris Photo 2 years ago, which once again gives you an idea of the scale and size of the images and how they end up. So I started working, after 2 years of working with a single mirror, I then wondered what would happen if we worked with an array of mirrors. And this brings us up to the last shoot that I did last year. But here's the behind the scenes we did on the dry year, which was 2018. So these were the final images that we exhibited last year. And I really do hope and think that I've now finally, after 17 or 18 years, 16 or 17 years, said goodbye to the project. That's a favourite. And to finish off, my assistant Nick, who you saw in the video there before, who's an up-and-coming photographer and videographer, asked me if he could bring a Super 8 camera and make his own behind-the-scenes footage, which we played at the exhibition. So there's a couple of swear words in this one, and it's a bit more lighthearted than some of the other ones, but I think it's a great way to finish off.
Good morning!
Fuck, it's warm.
Not right. Almost look t-shirt this time of day.
See, that's a good term I bust out every now and then. Crepuscular rays. Never make the mistake of buying quick oats if you try and emulate this.
That's washed there in a flood. That's come in a flood. That's Coolabah.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
Ow! Oh, it bit me on the leg! Oh. You don't want any residual pasta
sorry, water, it dilutes the pasta sauce.
Wow. The water's moved in.
It's moved in a bit. Our biggest risk is that the wind changes and blows the water away from where we set the mirrors up. That would suck.
Yeah.
That will suck.
Hey, what a gift. We got blown out by westerly and we're going to get pushed back in by an easterly. That's as fucking good as it gets out here. So as far as I'm concerned, we're still in business.
Stop shooting, I'm not going to be able to choose. Is that a high quality problem? This was a moment, wasn't it, today? Everything came together.
Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Oh, 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 oh.
But thank you very much for your attention. It is quite strange talking to a computer screen. I wish you were all in front of me and I could be getting the energy from an audience, but it's great to have this opportunity. So thanks again, thanks to FaZe, and thanks for watching.